Hey, I want to talk about a game design concept that I think every game designer and level designer should know. I think it's a term that should be taught at all game design courses, and it's often at the heart of a lot of games that I think you probably love. The concept I'm talking about is the idea of things being orthogonal, and this can be applied to things like enemy design, weapon design, and player abilities, and just game mechanics in general. I'm going to talk about some classic examples of it to me, including Doom, Left 4 Dead, Dishonored, immersive sims in general, and Tactical Breach Wizards, which is a new indie tactics game that I recently worked on that is coming out really soon. It's really good, by the way. You should buy it. And in case it sounds like this only applies to games with combat in, I'm also going to talk about it through the lens of Alba, a Wildlife Adventure, which is a very cute, wholesome game I worked on, which has no combat or violence in whatsoever. Let's take the example of, like, vehicles, right? Let's say there's a game that the player can use vehicles in, and in the non-orthogonal version of this game, the player might have three cars they can drive, and all of them are cars, but one of them is really fast, one of them isn't as fast as the others, but maybe is more robust and can take more damage or something like that, and maybe another one, I don't know, only has two seats instead of four or something like that, right? So there we have three different cars that the player could use that are different, but only in terms of numbers. So instead of this, the orthogonal version of this might be that instead of just having three cars that are really different, we could have a car, a helicopter, and a boat, right? And as soon as you have those three vehicles, we're talking very different characteristics, right? One of these is obviously built for the ground, one of them is for the sea, one of them is for the air. And you can do very different things with these vehicles. And they're orthogonally different because they're not just a matter of number changes, right? There's no amount of cars that you can combine together to make a helicopter. And no amount of helicopters will create a boat, right? And you can imagine that as a player and a game designer, if you have helicopters and speedboats and cars, you can do way more things than if you just have three cars. And that is the kind of difference we're talking about with orthogonal design. Examples. For me, the classic one, as often is the case, is Doom. You might have heard Mark Brown talk about this in his GMTK videos. He talked about Doom and the orthogonal design of the enemies in Doom. And this boils down to the idea that in Doom, you don't just have enemies that fire bullets. You have loads of different types of enemies that are orthogonally different to each other. And the three main categories of this are the ones that fire bullets at you, that hit you instantly, versus the one that fire projectiles at you, that travel at a certain speed towards you. And then you have melee enemies that have to be right next to you to attack you. These orthogonally different categories of enemies are basically the bread and butter of all the combat in Doom, but they allow for a lot of variation because of those different characteristics. All your combat choices vary based on the circumstances and the composition of these different types of enemies, which means that level designers can create loads and loads of different, consistently interesting situations for you to be in, which is what level designers want to do. I got into level design by making Doom levels way back in the day, about 30 years ago. Terrifying. And that taught me the benefit, the value of orthogonal enemy design. Since then, I've tried to make levels for games that have less orthogonal enemy design, and it's way harder to come up with loads of interesting situations. Because often when enemies are not orthogonal, and they only vary in terms of numbers, often they don't really change the way the player has to play the situation as much as they would if they were dealing with a combination of orthogonal enemies. If the enemies don't change the way the player has to play the game, they're just less interesting, and it's harder to make lots of interesting situations to encounter them. And so orthogonal game design helps level design be easy to do a good job. And that's one of the reasons why all game designers and level designers should know about it. Now let's talk about Dishonored 1, which I think is one of the best of all time examples of orthogonal player abilities. And by this, I mean the powers in that game, like Blink and Bend Time and Possession and Dark Vision. These powers are super orthogonal and different. Blink is a movement-based power that allows you to teleport, basically, whereas Dark Vision allows you to see through walls, and Possession allows you to possess people and effectively become them, and Bend Time allows you to manipulate time. If you can teleport and stop time and see through walls and change who you are, you can do all kinds of things. And like I said with the enemy design in Doom, the orthogonal nature of the player abilities in Dishonored is a key part of why you can combine them in such interesting ways, and why there is consequently such a huge possibility space for how the player deals with problems in that game. I often talk about a book that I love called 101 Things I Learned at Architecture School. And it has loads of things in it that have interesting parallels to level design. And there's even one about simplicity in there, which has really great parallels to game design and specifically orthogonal game design. Yeah, maybe I can. Let me find it. Hold on. There we go. So you won't be able to see this very well unless I hold it about there. Oh, no, that's in focus, but it's tiny. So I'll show you this on the screen. Okay, so I'm talking about a section called Three Levels of Knowing, which it describes as simplicity, complexity, and finally, informed simplicity. And basically, to me, informed simplicity is what orthogonal game design looks like. If we look at the diagram on the right, we see how informed simplicity allows us to create 12 different spaces using only three elements combined. And to me, those three elements could well be blink, possess, and bend time in Dishonored. Three simple but powerful and orthogonal abilities which can combine in super interesting ways. And so this diagram about informed simplicity really speaks to me about the power and the elegance of orthogonal game design. It's really like if you get it right, you can have very few elements creating a really interesting, rich possibility space. And that means that you can create really interesting, rich games for players without having 500 mechanics. The holy grail of game design is always to have less mechanics, but brilliant mechanics that allow you to do loads of interesting things. And again, that's just a really good spot to be in as a level designer, to be on a game where the game design offers you loads of interesting possibilities. Example number three is Left 4 Dead, which has brilliantly orthogonal enemy design. And this is in the context of a first-person shooter, a co-op game that needs to be played forever. And they did this, and maybe could have only done this, with orthogonal enemy design. So you have the normal zombies who are actually quite fast and in large numbers once they've spotted you can be quite dangerous. But the real juice of the game is all these special zombies like the hunter, the smoker, the witch, and the tank. So all of those enemies are designed to perform very specific, very orthogonal functions in that game. And as a result of them all being so orthogonal, different combinations of all of those enemies create a consistently different dynamic feeling experience. Imagine if they tried to make a Left 4 Dead game that you want to play forever with just a load of humans with guns. And some of the guns do more damage and some of the guns fire faster, but they're all basically guys with guns. That would never have worked. And it's the orthogonal nature of the enemy design that makes Left 4 Dead work. And it's partly why a lot of Left 4 Dead clones are not as good as Left 4 Dead, because the enemy designs aren't as orthogonal and the situations they generate are not as varied and interesting. Example number four is Tactical Breach Wizards, which is this lovely indie tactics game I recently worked on. It's a tactics game, a squad-based one where all of your characters in your squad are completely different, orthogonally different characters with different abilities. And all of the enemies you face are orthogonally different too. They have very different abilities. And as a level designer working on this game, there was always so much stuff to do by combining different combinations of the player's wizards and the enemies, hopefully presenting you with new interesting situations all the time. The lead on the project is Tom Francis, who loves games like Immersive Sims, and Breach Wizards, like his previous games, Gunpoint and Heat Signature, draw a lot from that school of orthogonal game design. I think maybe tactics games in general are always about this because it's the way to make them interesting. When I think about the classic ones like Advance Wars, Into the Breach, I think of like XCOM. XCOM is really orthogonal with its enemy design, but the players' units, they do fall more into the category of just being people with different types of gun, right? So XCOM is an example of a tactics game where the players' abilities are designed in terms of number differences, and they're less orthogonal, while the enemy design is more orthogonal. And obviously it can work. But Breach Wizards is both, and it's pretty cool. So I think you should go buy it. All right, the last example number five, was Alba, a Wildlife Adventure, which you might have seen my other video about. I made a video about the level and world design work that I did on it. This is obviously not a combat game. It's a game about taking photos of animals and noting them down in your little book and having conversations with people and fixing things for the community. But as you might have already noticed from my description of it there, the player's abilities in this game are really orthogonal. If you think about what these mechanics allow you to do, one of them allows you to fix things, which means that you can open up new navigation options, and then you have a camera to take photos of things, and there's talking to people and having conversations and nodding or shaking your head to decide if you want to eat an ice cream.
Thank you very much. Yes, give me ice cream. Yes, ice cream.
Important stuff like this. And so you can imagine how those mechanics are all very different, and as a level designer or a quest designer on this game, it helps you come up with interesting ideas for quests. And so even Alba, which obviously has no combat in it whatsoever, benefits a lot from orthogonal game design. And I just thought I'd throw that in there just to make sure that people don't think this is just a combat game thing. So yeah, I think that's it. I hope this was useful. Like I say, I think it's something that all game designers should know and that all level designers would benefit from if all game designers knew it. And yeah, hope it was useful. Share it around if you know of people who might be into it. And cheers for watching. See ya.